Hello, everyone. Welcome to Screwtape Letters, Chapter 27 and 28. We're reaching the end, which is exciting. Let us start off this afternoon with prayer. Father, Son, Holy Spirit, amen. Dear Lord, we thank you for this beautiful weather we've been having and the warm weather. We just pray that we have a wonderful summer and that our upcoming events go awesome. And that we have a great time today learning about the ways that we can protect ourselves from the devil. In Jesus' name, amen. Father, Son, Holy Spirit, amen. Okay, so, chapter 27, a lot of it is distractions and prayer. So right when I read this chapter, I immediately thought of, I think the dog's name is Doug from Up. He's like, he's talking to the, I don't know that what the guy's name is, but he's the mailman, or that is from Doug's point of view, and he's, talking to him, and then all of a sudden he says squirrel, and then he gets patient. So that's like us sometimes with our prayer. We get distracted like squirrel. So how does the devil do this? So distraction. This is what the Screwtape has to say about this. When this or any other distraction crosses his mind, you ought to encourage him to thrust it away by sheer willpower and try to continue the normal prayer as if nothing had happened. Once he accepts the distraction as his present problem and lays that before the enemy and makes it the main theme of his prayers and endeavors, then so far from doing good, you have done harm. So what C.S. Lewis is saying in this point with Screwtape is that, you know, the devil throws distractions into our mind. You know, he wants us to, you know, divert away from prayer to get distracted from our focus, which is prayer. But sometimes this can, you know, backfire on them, but do good to us by us laying, you know, our problems at the feet of Jesus because he can always solve them. But when I was thinking about this, I, you know, was thinking about, there's this one video here. From Ascension, and it's the exact same thing as the Jesus, and it's very, you know, so this person here goes into a conversation about, you know, prayer and how sometimes, even though you may be distracted, if you still focus, you know, your attention on God and keep coming back to the full circle, just like Doug from the movie Up came back to the conversation, it still shows that you love God very much. And I just really thought this was very powerful, and I hope you guys enjoy too. Wraps up this whole chapter perfectly.
A little bit about distractions, a little bit of the struggle of prayer, mm-hmm. and I think a little bit of like what God sees in the struggle and Amen. In the distractions.
Absolutely, yeah. So yeah, I was blessed to spend time with a family just this morning, actually, some good friends, and was talking with them just about everything going on in life in general, but the wife, Deirdre, she began to ask me about just prayer and like staying focused and being distracted. She's got four kids, you know, and all these things in her mind and like, how do I do this? And I like turned to her. I was like, Deirdre, I've been a friar for 12 years. We've got like 4 hours a day dedicated to prayer. Two of those hours are like silent meditative prayer. I still get distracted. So I was just like, I don't mean that to be discouraging. I mean to just let you know that like the struggle's real and it's part of our human experience of actually entering into prayer. In fact, the catechism, if you go check out section 3 on prayer, has a whole little like paragraph or two dedicated to distraction. So we know this is part of the experience. So how do we deal with it? And also, how does God see it? And I think those two things are important. So first off, I'd like to talk about an experience I had with one of my spiritual directors early on in religious life. Because, you know, you show up, you think, all right, I'm a friar now, I've got a habit, I'm holy, I'm praying every day, I'm ready for mystical experiences. You're like, you know, I'm all geared up, I'm amped. And then here I am, 45 minutes out of the hour of my meditation hour in the morning, and I've just seemingly chased around this like hamster wheel of thoughts and things and emotions and plans and to-dos. And and my mind's all over the place. And I'm just like constantly just trying to like, can I focus, 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 focus. And so I'm like, all right, I'm back again, Jesus. Sorry, I went off on another tangent. Back again, Jesus, went off on another tangent, in and out. So I'm in that place, frustrated. I bring it to spiritual direction. And I'm like, I don't know what to do. Like, I'm sitting here trying to pray, and I'm just thinking about everything else except for God and being with Him. And it's just frustrating. It's disappointing. It's like, bah, like, what do I do? And he was like, so tell me again, what was going on? I said, all right. So like basically 45 minutes straight, I'm just like getting distracted and then trying, you know, like to like get back at it, focus again. And I get distracted again. And he's like, okay, hold on a second. Let me just stop you and clarify something. I'm like, okay, what? And he's like, so for 45 minutes, you were being pulled away from Jesus by distractions in your prayer. I was like, yeah. He was like, and so for 45 minutes, you kept kind of trying to get back focus and turn your heart back to Jesus. I'm like, yeah, I tried. Totally failed. And he was like, don't you think that it was pleasing to the Lord's heart that you spent 45 minutes choosing Him again and again and again and again? And it was just this grace of an insight from myself to see, wow, like, yeah, I was distracted, but my heart wanted Him and kept trying to come back to Him. And what a joy and blessing it was for Him to see that. And think about this. Here's the analogy. Any mom, any dad out there, when your little baby is just on the threshold between crawling and walking, and that baby holds onto the piece of furniture, stable, stable, and you're just like, oh, this is awesome. You're so excited, and then plops back down on his bottom, then gets back up, and a couple days later seems to be like maybe taking one step, and then falls down, and then gets back up. It's like, do you as a parent get disappointed? Or do you rejoice that this little child is trying to take first steps towards you, who are on the other side of the room saying, come on, you can do it, you can do it, come on. And Abba is looking at us, His beloved children, in prayer. And He's like, come on, you can do it. Yeah, it's like, I know you fell. Don't worry. It's okay. You're learning how to walk. You've never done this before. And in the world today, you're learning how to be still, brothers and sisters, in a world that is filled with frenetic activity and noise. So if it's hard, yeah, yeah. You're distracted, yeah. Just get up and turn your heart back to Jesus. And He's going to be smiling and overjoyed by that fact that you're coming.
But this is the whole topic of distraction. Yeah. This slide right here. Okay, so when that video reminded me a lot about this here, except that even though Screwtape says that, you know, when distraction crosses his mind, you will encourage him to thrust it away by sheer willpower and try to continue the normal prayers, nothing had happened. When you think about it this way, you know, he says Screwtape saying that this is good for them, but at the same time, it's also good for us because, you know, we're throwing away that thought, focusing back on God, you know, in the prayer. And yes, our minds may get distracted again, but we throw it away and we just become focused again. We're the winning team. And, just like the guy said in the video too, I love the analogy that he made with the baby who's walking, you know. The baby is focusing so hard on trying to stand and take its first steps, but he falls right back down onto his bottom. It's kind of like us prepare. Sometimes we have, you know, days where like random thoughts keep flying into our head, kind of like a fly buzzing around the room. You know, they're just, it's just there. But if we, you know, throw that away, if we put the feet on, we the person we are trying to pray about, or just Jesus in general. So I love this video. It was absolutely perfect. It's on YouTube, Ascension, it's called. That's the group Nope, don't want to play again. I want to go to the next slide. And, okay. This chapter continues on with other frustrations with prayer. You know, Screwtape goes on to say, and one of those big frustrations is not having your prayer come true right away. Sometimes things take a long time. I think it was St. Monica. Like, she prayed so long for her son to, you know, become, you know, to the Catholic Church and, you know, meet God and Jesus in his life. And she never gave up with the praying. And eventually her son did come, you know, to know Jesus and change his life. I always look up to her. She's awesome with that. But especially in our society, instant gratification is a big thing. So you, up here, you know, we have DoorDash, you know, want to get your food, get it like that, you know, right there. Same with Grubhub. You're hungry, press this button and food will come to your door. Amazon too, you know, we have all those, you know, one day delivery. You click the button, say order, next day you wake up, oh, look, it's there. Wow, that was so fast. And it becomes part of our, you know, everyday lives. We want things to happen immediately. And this even goes for kids too. There's a psychology study called like the marshmallow experiment, which I love. It's so cute, the little kitties. And so the experiment is to see if they can, you know, withhold desire to eat the marshmallow. Like, so the person gives them the choice. You can either eat the marshmallow, or if you wait a certain amount of time, you'll get two marshmallows. So some psychologists say that, you know, if a kid eats the marshmallow, you know, they are going to be more wanting of things like right away. And if they wait for the marshmallow, they'll be more successful. That's what they say, but I'm not so sure. So we have a cute little video here of that marshmallow experiment because, you know, why not? It's little kids. Let's see. Load.
Good. Okay, so here's the deal. There's a marshmallow. You can either wait, and I'll bring you back another one, so you can have two, or you can eat it now. So you can eat it now, or you can wait, and I'll bring you back two. Okay?
Okay.
Okay, I'll be back. Okay, so I have one marshmallow for each of you.
Okay. Don't eat it.
And here's the deal. You can either eat it now, or you can wait till I get back, and you can have two. Okay?
Okay.
So eat it now or wait till I get back and you can have two. And I'll be back in a little bit.
If we wait, you'll get us two?
Yep, if you wait, you'll get two. Or you can eat it now, whichever you want. Okay?
I'll be back in a little bit. Sorry. I'm gonna wait. She'll give you two. She still won't give you two because you ate it. So love it. And I didn't eat a single bite of mine. So don't show her, okay?
Or if you wait a little bit, I'll bring back two for you, okay? Well, I'm gonna go and I haven't found marshmallows yet, so I'm gonna look for some more. But you stay here, and if you haven't eaten that one, I'll bring you back another one, okay? I'll be right back.
Waiting. Well, you're eating, not waiting. Where'd they give that? Wait, what? Still ate some of it, though. Still good.
And it's lagging.
Hi, Hunter, you waited! You get two! Good job! You can eat it! You can eat them now!
They're probably wondering why it should be the whole. First of all, it's adorable.
They were trying to focus so hard on other things so that they wouldn't eat the marshmallow. Just like, and it's funny how some of them, you know, were distracted and ate the marshmallow because, you know, they couldn't distract themselves enough from eating the marshmallow. But it kind of reminds me of this whole marshmallow experiment, you know, with the instant gratification of prayer. You know, it reminds me a lot about prayer too, because, you know, sometimes we want the thing, whatever we're praying about, to have immediately so we get to experience that sweetness, or, you know, that awesome experience that we've been waiting for a long time. But sometimes, you know, it just takes a lot of time and you just got to wait for it. But when it does happen, it's essentially like you're getting two marshmallows. You get the best, you know, because you each, kind of like when you're going on vacation, you're looking so forward to going on vacation, the excitement's just building and building and building. So inside, you know, as the, you know, prayer continues, you're like, maybe another day. And, you know, it just, it's building. Just like St. Monica, for example. She never gave up. Okay, what are your thoughts on chapter 27? It was a fun one. I love this one.
Yeah, I think you did a great job covering it with the examples there, especially the video from the two friars on distraction and prayer. And I think
That was really good.
That's perfectly summarized. And I'd like to add one other thing that I know is very important. When, like with the quote that you used for Screwtape, there's really two ways that we can handle distraction in prayer. One is to recenter ourselves, like the friar was saying, and then, or we just bring our distractions before Jesus and say, Lord, I'm trying to pray, but this is right here. And that's good. Or we can sit there and beat ourselves up about getting distracted, which isn't good. Because like they said in the video, God is our Father, and He looks at the little steps that we're trying to take while walking. So I just want to encourage everybody that, like, everybody gets distracted in prayer. The main point is getting back up, kind of recentering your focus, realizing when you've shifted. And the example that you use, Shannon, about like thoughts coming in and out of your head, that's going to be thoughts. Like, that's just how we are. Thoughts float in and out, sometimes for no reason. But it's the thoughts that we pay attention to that matter. And for instance, let's say there is a distraction, a practical tip that I've heard, let's say that you're in prayer, but there's something that you know is on your schedule that's busy, or you remember something for your to-do list. A religious brother that I knew that I lived with for a little while, many years ago, he said that when he would get distracted in prayer, he would always bring a little note card and then he'd take it out of his pocket and write down what the distraction was and then put it back away. That way he acknowledged it, dealt with it, and he could revisit it later after his prayer time was over. So that could be a practical thing. Like, let's say you think about like, oh, I need to do this for homework. I need to do this for mom and dad later. Or I remembered I was going to call my friend. Okay, write it down and then just pocket it and continue praying. That could be a great practical to use, but especially the encouragement of, yeah, knowing that God loves us and he sees us as a loving father, and that when we struggle in prayer to focus, that we shouldn't indict ourselves, but we should open ourselves up and know that God sees the effort. And I think the way that one friar told his story about the spiritual director was beautiful, because really, what is prayer other than that thirsting of our heart, that grasping of our heart for God? And when we get distracted, we're trying to go back. And even say, let's say we give in to distraction for a little bit and we find that we're taken away. Well, instead of beating ourselves up for that distraction, just shift back. Say, Lord, I'm sorry I got distracted. I put myself back in your presence. Because that's such an important thing for us to do too. And then on the second point of the chapter, especially about like, we pray so that we might get discouraged, like if our prayer doesn't come true, right? We need to get out of that mindset where we think of God as a genie. Mm-hmm. He's not a genie with a magic lamp. He's not Santa. We don't ask. And if we're really, really good, he gives us whatever we want, right? In the Gospels, Jesus tells us that does not the rain and the sun alike both fall on sinners and those who are righteous, right? So good things happen to bad people, bad things happen to good people. There's that aspect of it. But remember that God's will is always for the ultimate good of you and I. So if we're praying and we don't get something that we think is really good that we're praying for, it could be that God's answer to our prayer is different, because God sees the whole picture of what will ultimately make us happy and lead us towards heaven, what will ultimately be good for us, right? Just like a parent knows what's good for their child. Like a parent who knows that the child is allergic to peanuts. If the child really wants a peanut butter and jelly sandwich, the parent will say no. If the child's hungry and it's like, I'm hungry, I want the peanut butter and jelly sandwich, the parent knows in the long run that's not going to make them feel very good. So they give them something different. In an infinite more way, like the gap between parent and child of understanding about what's good for us is the gap between God and ourselves, where sometimes we might be praying, Lord, if you just give me this job, if you just allow me to get into this program, if you just help me through this struggle and fix this right away, right, then everything will be okay.
But then you could laugh too, you know, because sometimes you may think that it's really good and it's not good at all. Like, you know, you may be like, oh, I really hope that I get this job. Please that I get this job. And then like you don't get the job. And further on, like a bigger door opens, you know, they're like, wow, this is like meant to be. This is awesome. I'm glad that I didn't get that job.
Absolutely. Because like what we're asking for ultimately is doing God's will. Yep. And sometimes when we pray, the answer is no, the answer is yes, the answer is not yet, or the answer is like in a different way.
Yes.
God answers every single prayer. We just have to have ears and humility to listen, because prayer is not about just asking and receiving, right? That's an aspect of prayer, supplication, petition, but prayer more than anything is about building that relationship with the one who loves us. And if we have that relationship and trusting God's love, that when we're praying and it's frustrating and it feels like nothing's happening, then we'll be open with the eyes of faith. We all need to get to this point and work on this. All of us struggle with this, no matter what phase of your life of faith, whether you're just starting out, you've been doing this for years, everybody struggles with this, where it's like, Lord, what's going on? This is my prayer. But if we journey with him, and if we try to make the priority being relationship with Christ and inviting him into the day-to-day moments, then in hindsight, we might, like you said, Shannon, be able to see where, oh, God said no to this. I thought this was going to be what's best for me, but he opened this door later on in the future. And that was really what was the best thing that I needed. So a lot of that is humility and trusting that, well, God knows better than I do. what's good. So I think those two things really do tie together, because if we don't cultivate that relationship, then we look at distractions as black and white, as being I'm doing good or I'm not doing good in prayer, instead of just parts of a dynamic conversation with the Lord. And we also view things through that lens of, God, what have you done for me lately? Which is not love, but is trying to put God in a position where we want to control him by rubbing the magic lamp, which he's not a genie. God is, I mean, being itself, goodness itself, life itself. And he knows what's best for us in that sense. So just my two observations on those two points, which I think were brilliantly fleshed out by those videos. Because so often we can be the little kid, because it's like we don't trust that God really has something good in store for us. And what do we do sometimes when we don't trust that God has something in store? We kind of, like the prodigal son, try to go off on our own and create our own happiness. Where sometimes if we know, if we just wait, if we remain faithful, the reward is better, that heavenly kingdom, the gift of life that we receive, more full life in our present life. So kind of my reflections on 27 there.
That's good. I like it. This, I think, was one of my favorite chapters of all of the chapters.
Absolutely.
It was just really awesome. It spoke to me a lot. Okay, let's see now. Okay, chapter 28. It's about, you know, death, or, you know, the ending life of a person, and, you know, how, you know, what Screwtape's or the devil's perspective is on it. So, as you know, the Screwtape Letters is written on, like, C.S. Lewis wrote this during the time of World War II, when there's a lot of scary things going on with the war, and people were frightened and very scared for their lives. So, in regards, oopsies, wrong button. So, in regards to the book, at the time, in this chapter, you know, the patient is really worried for his life because, like, there were really bad planes that were going to fly over his house, and he and his girlfriend and his girlfriend's mom and his mom, and they're all just really scared for their lives. And, you know, Wormwood, who is the patient's devil, is really excited about this. He's like, oh, this is great. You know, he could probably die and come to us. And Screwtape's like, no, you want him to live. And, you know, Screwtape goes on to explain why he wants him to live. So Wormwood should be trying to keep the patient alive. And, you know, young tempters like Wormwood are being swayed by hell's own propaganda, writes Screwtape. Hell has made humans think of death is evil, but if their souls are prepared like death, like the patient's is, death is a good thing for them, because if you die in a good state, you'll go right up there. There's a joke that the pastor of my church says, whenever he goes to confession, it's always like the line of sadness, like it's just so sad, you know, people are like all somber in the line going to confession. But you know, when he mentioned it at a mass a few years ago, he's like, I'm happy when I go on the line, because, you know, if at that moment, you know, something happens to me, I'm going right up there, because I, you know, am standing in the line. You know, I'm going to be, you know, my sins are going to be forgiven. And so whenever you go to confession, you're always worried and scared. Think of it happily. Think, I'm in the line. I'm good. And it's just a fun thing. And, you know, like, death is a good thing for, like, the patient in this time. And it brings them closer to God, or the enemy, so-called, letters. Screwtape also talks a lot about how, you know, they capture a human soul better if they have more time on their hands. So Screwtape says, 70 years is not a day too much for the difficult task of unraveling their souls from heaven and building a firm attachment to the earth. The longer a person lives on earth, the more experiences they have, and the more time that the devil has to unravel the faith that they once had when they were children, or, you know, at some point in their life. And C.S. Lewis actually experienced this. You know, C.S. Lewis grew up in a religious household. And then, you know, when he was a teenager, he fell away from the faith. and he didn't come back to it until the middle of his life. And funny thing, with his works, you know, because prior to his, you know, conversion, you know, all of his works were definitely not religious at all. Like, he was totally against, like, a lot of the things that religious are for. But it wasn't until he, you know, had some spiritual conversations with Tolkien, who, if you didn't know, wrote The Lord of the Rings, they're best buds. And not until, you know, that day that he started to, you know, have a big reawakening. And he's like, wow, I left all of that behind, you know, just because, you know, it's the best gift ever. And that's when he started writing all of his books and stuff. So, you know, devils can, you know, really unravel a person's faith. You know, so many people think, unfortunately, in today's world that, like, oh, this happened because God made it happen. No, that's not the case. God is always rooting for us, not against us. If, you know, God, as the pastor of my church says, he says this quite often, if God, if you're going through it, God can use it. That's it. You know, that's the big saying. You know, it's not placed but there by God. It's just there because it's there, and you can use that. You know, God, if you're going through it, God can use it. Things can always come out of bad things. And this is just what Screwtape's saying, how with time, you know, a lot of people, you know, think, oh, well, I have time, you know, to talk about, figure out my spiritualness before the end. It goes in a blink of an eye in God's time. You know, a day in his time is like 100 years in our time. And that is the end of chapter 28. What are your thoughts on this one?
So my thoughts on this are very brief, but I think it's very powerful that death is not a fun topic to speak about.
No.
But it is one of the important things that the church reflects on. It's called the four last things: death, judgment, heaven, and hell. And that's traditionally been something that the church and the faithful have meditated on, because ultimately I've heard this from a priest up in Massachusetts when I was on a silent retreat up at a monastery. And he said in his homily, the most important moment of your life is your last, and whether or not you're in a state of grace. And that's very much the point here, that it lets us know that we live in such a way that, as Jesus taught us, we are pilgrims in this world, and our home world, our home, is to be in heaven with God. And that's the whole idea of, like, the devil tries to make us so attached to the world, so attached to earthly pleasures, so attached to these things that we put them above God. When in reality, the created goods of this world are good in their right order, in their right understanding, and as long as they lead us closer to God. So as Catholics, as Christians, we're not an anti-world people. No, that's a heresy. That's Gnosticism, where it says we're just spirit good, body bad. No, we are an incarnational people. Where we are body and spirit together, where the created goods of this world are good. But as long as they're ordered properly in our understanding and appreciation of them to God, if we're more attached to our, we're more attached to our favorite TV show or favorite sporting event than we are to prayer or going to Mass, right? That's an aspect of our heart that we need to look at, because our hearts need to be for God first and foremost, without anything above him. And that's what is talking about with that unraveling, more chances to get attached to things. But the life of holiness is the life of detachment, in the sense of we can hold things in our hands that are gifts from God, created things, without grasping at them and trying to make them God. And if we're in that state of grace, if we, like Shannon had said, like you said, if we are in the line, right, repenting of our sins and continually going to God on a daily basis, on even minute to minute, hour to hour basis, for keeping Jesus in our mind and in our hearts during the day, we're going to be more focused on him and more ready. Just like Jesus says that parable about the 10 virgins, the 5 who had their lamps lit and the 5 who didn't, right? Being ready, because you never know when that moment will come. Because like that priest said, that I mentioned, said the most important moment is your last, when you die and have judgment before you. And it's heaven and hell that are laid before us. It's, do I want to be with God for all eternity, or do I want to be attached to the things of this world or my own selfish gains? And with God, we want to choose him. And that's what cultivating this life of faith, living this out day after day, that consistency of going to him is about, working towards that journey to heaven. Because guess what? None of us get out of this life alive. We're in this together. But as a patron of the group, the Secular Oratory of St. Philip Neri, that I'm a part of, the oratorians in our way of life, they speak to St. Philip's reminder, which is, in the end, we all must die and render an account to God. So remembering that in the end, that's how our lives will end. That's the end. It's the same for all of us. And it's the question of not being afraid of it, but being aware that what are we journeying towards? And that our life on this earth is a preparation for being with God in heaven. And it's not to be afraid of death, but to understand that death is something that comes, and more importantly, to pray for the grace to be with God when we die. And for those who we know that may have passed on before us, to pray for them, for their souls, so that they can be with God as well. That's the importance of praying for the dead, what the church offers masses for, of praying to make sure that, to offer our petitions for the salvation of souls, so that they can be with God in their death and in eternal life. So just 2 very quick thoughts to keep in mind. And that can be a very daunting thought, that the most important of your life is your last. But if you live in that sense, then how transforming would that be to your day-to-day life? And I'll leave you with this. I'll leave you all with this. I read this a long time ago and it stuck with me. It said, live each moment as if it were your last moment. And also live each moment as if you would live that moment forever. Meaning, what is the way that you want to live your life? We want to live our lives in love with God, in relationship, to serve, to be with other people, to bring kindness and goodness to others. It's like, if we're thinking about wanting to live that moment, knowing that we want to be in God's good graces, if we live each moment of our life like it was our last, how transforming can that be? Is it easy? No, absolutely not. I think it's something that we can all think about, that can really be convicting. And if we try to live it out, can really be changing, because then we focus on what really matters.
Another thing that got me thinking, it was something you said that made me remember this. The priest in my church, he says this sometimes, you know how the church is thought of as a wedding banquet. Question is, that he sometimes asks us parishioners is, who are the people who attend a wedding? And everyone's like, oh, the people who are friends and family and stuff. And then he always says, no, the people who accept the invitation. So it always just it's a very powerful statement, like the people who are focused on of heaven and God and stuff are
absolutely
taking the invitation.
That's
cool. Well, that is the end of this. Next week will be the last three chapters because, you know, they're quite short. And, you know, it's fun, you know, to read it. So next three chapters for next week is 29, 30, and 31. And then you guys did it. It's awesome. Awesomeness. So let's finish up with a prayer, and then I think we have a few announcements that we'll do. In the name of Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Amen. Dear Lord, we thank you for this awesome Screwtape session. The videos that I found online were awesome. I'm so thankful that you led me to them because I was thinking that I wanted to do videos and I'm like, I don't know which ones. And all of a sudden, boom, there they were. I'm like, oh, this is perfect. It went into play perfectly. And I think a lot of us got a lot of things out of this. I know that I did. And we just pray that our next book study, which is our last, goes well. And that we have a wonderful rest of our day. In Jesus' name, Father, Son.
Thank you so much, Shannon, and thank you for all of your leadership during our book study, mm-hmm. and throughout. We're finishing up the book next week. So a couple things, we're starting some Summer Newman events. You can stay tuned on social media for that. Immediately upcoming is this week, we're going to be having on Sunday at 3 p.m. A hike at Cheesequake in Matawan, New Jersey. So you can check that out. And check our social media for more information. And it's in anticipation of us being back live in the fall. So hopefully everything, we can see you guys there. But that's all we got. So God bless and hope you guys have a great rest of the week.